Hello everyone, good morning. I hope you had a great weekend. So today we are going to discuss a little bit about biotechnology and its applications. Now the thing with biotechnology is what we have learned in the previous classes is that there's a lot of technology. When we have studied biology, we have studied about animals, we've studied about plants, we have studied about so many things. But when it comes to biotechnology, this is where the technology comes into play in the field of biology. Okay, we take everything, we take plants, we take animals, we take microbes, and use the technology towards the betterment of those living beings. Okay, so today we'll be learning about those kind of applications. Now, the thing is, what we'll learn today are different type of techniques, be it towards the betterment of agriculture, towards the betterment of food, towards the betterment of medicine. So everything we'll be learning about today. Okay, so before starting, I'd like to say a little bit about who we are. We are practically, and we have a lot of courses running in our app, okay, which runs from 6th grade to 12th grade. And there's a lot of videos and simulations and so many other interesting things which I'm sure you'll like. Okay, and you can follow us on Facebook, what and on Instagram and on YouTube also, and you can rate your experience from your iPhones and your Android phones. Okay, so coming into the subject. Okay, as I said, biotechnology. What it is, biotechnology is when we know biology, what biology is. Biology is the science, is the study for living things. Okay, be it plants, be it animals, be it microbes, so many things are into play. Okay, so biotechnology is where the technology comes into the whole biology thing. Okay, so one second. Okay, so technology comes to play in biology. This is what biotechnology basically means when we put technology towards biology. Now, there are a lot of fields where this biotechnology has been utilized. We have learned what is biotechnology in the previous class. We have learned what is biotechnology? What are the different basics of biotechnology? The fundamental ideas about plasmids, about cloning, palindromes, etc. So many things we have learned. But now we learn about the real world examples. Okay, so we'll start a little bit with the food technology. Okay, then we'll go into the cattle breeding and cattle. We'll talk about medical diagnosis. I'll talk a little bit about environmental management, food, pharmaceuticals and RDNA technology. All of these things we'll discuss, but the thing is, what you have to understand is everything is interrelated. Okay, so and if you have any doubts, please put it in the chat box so that we can interact. Also, you might have had a lot of doubts when we talk about these things because everything is interrelated. Okay, so if you have any doubts, please put it in the chat box. Okay, so first we'll discuss about basically we'll talk about the genetically modified product. Genetically modified as in these are biotech related products. Okay, when you change the genetic line, okay, when you change the genetically modify it genetically and you use biotechnology, it becomes GMOs. So that is what, okay, that is what we'll be discussing about today. Okay, so first, as I said, we'll be discussing about food and agriculture. Okay, so today, first, we'll be discussing about that. So, what is that? Now, when biotechnology comes into agriculture, a lot of things happens. Okay, we use a lot of agrochemical-based agriculture, organic agriculture, and genetically engineered crop-based agriculture. A lot of agriculture comes into play. So, first, before that, before I discuss how biotechnology is changing the world agriculturally, first I'd like to talk a little bit about the Green Revolution. Now, what was the Green Revolution? This is not a part of biotechnology, but this is what started the biotechnological revolution. Okay, so Green Revolution was basically seen in the 1940s, 1950s, and 1960s. Okay, and this green revolution was started by a person called Norman Borlaug. Okay, so what he did, he saw that there is a lot of what to say, a lot of difference. Okay, there's a lot of gap between the consumer taking the products and the growing of products. Okay, so food, there was a lot of gap between food produced and food consumed. Okay, so he understood that the food has to be produced more. During that time, there was a lot of famine, droughts, these things were happening a lot. So there was not a lot of food being produced, especially crops, wheat, rice, those things and all were not brought properly. So this is what this person, Norman Borlaug, saw. And he started this green revolution in a place called Mexico. Okay, everyone knows Mexico. Okay, it's a part of North America. So Mexico, and then it traveled through Philippines. It came to India as well, went to China and Brazil. So what he did, he said that some kind of specific kind of agrochemicals, he basically what he did was he modernized. Okay, he modernized agriculture. Okay, with the help of what? With the help of a very high yielding crops, and then a lot of pesticides. Okay, these things, agrochemicals. He asked the farmers to use a lot of high yielding crops, a lot of pesticides, agrochemicals. So what happened? This improved the crops, the production. It improved the crop production. And the crops were not affected by a lot of insects, etc., and a lot of pests because they were using pesticides and agrochemicals. So what happened eventually? The food supply was actually tripled because of this modernization. It was tripled. Okay. And it actually helped in eradicating poverty and famine. Okay. So it became very popular and actually it created a lot of buzz and it was actually very effective. But what Norman Borlaug did not understand was that these chemicals and agrochemicals and pesticides were pretty expensive for farmers. Okay, they were very expensive for farmers. Especially this problem was seen in Africa. Okay, in Africa, it was seen that it was very costly for farmers. So what they did, they had to, although this solved a lot of problems, okay, a lot of food problems was solved by Green Revolution, but this was not a permanent solution. Okay, so although this was quite effective and it actually eradicated a lot of poverty and it eradicated the famine problems, but this was not a permanent solution. Okay, so this is where the genetically modified plants were introduced in mostly the 1990s, 1980s, and the early 2000s and all. They started working on the genetically modified plants. So what they did, these did not incorporate, these were just plants. They were from inside only, they were so effective that they did not need any kind of pesticides or insecticides or agrochemicals to take the pests away. From inside only, they were effective enough. And they could do a lot of more things. They were better in nitrogen fixation. They were tolerant to cold, drought, salt, heat, because they were genetically modified. Their gene was modified. Okay, so they were tolerant to abiotic stress, and they did not, as I said, they did not need chemical pesticides because from inside only they had the genes to actually fight off the pests. Genes to fight pests. Okay, so they did not need an external agency. Okay, and they reduced the post-harvest losses. Okay, efficiency was increased, disease-resistant crop, because there was no pesticides attacking. They themselves were working as pesticides, so there was no disease resistant. There was a lot of disease resistant also. Okay, so this was a lot better than what Green Revolution started. Green Revolution started something. They started to work towards plants, and then this was known as the gene revolution. This genetically modified plants, this was known as the gene revolution. That was Green Revolution. This was gene revolution. Okay. Now we'll talk a little bit about what is happening in the pest resistant plants, or what was happening in the genetically modified plants. Okay, so first, one of the best techniques they actually started was the introduction of BT plants. Okay, BT plants, as in BT here means Bacillus thuringiensis. Okay, this is a kind of bacteria. And this bacteria had a kind of toxin, a protein which worked as a toxin. Okay, so this worked as a poison for toxin towards the pests. Okay, so what they did, they directly introduced the gene into the plants via seeds. Okay, so this gene which codes this protein or toxin, the gene which codes the protein or toxin, they directly introduced it via the seeds. Okay, so now seeds will have that gene which produces the toxin. Okay, now this toxin stays in the plant in a very inactivated state. Okay, the toxin is inactivated in plants. Okay, it's not activated. It works only when it goes inside the pest. That time only it will work as a toxin. Okay, so this is what happens. See, this gene is inserted into the crop. Okay, now toxin is in protein crystals. As I said, the protein, the toxin was protein crystal and exists as inactive protoxins. Okay, now when it goes inside the insect, or when it goes inside the pest, okay, it works, it is activated. Okay, so this, as I said, it was the gene which works is called as the cry gene. Okay, the toxin which gives the protein, that gene was encoded by the cry gene, and this is a very important question for NEET. Okay, So what happens? See, that cry protein in the plant, it goes, okay, in the plant it goes, and then the pests attack. Okay, now the plant already has the cry protein. Okay, plant already has the cry toxin that goes, which is in inactivated form. Sorry, in inactivated form. Okay, now it goes inside the plants. The pests feed on the plants and it goes inside the body of the insect, this cry toxin. Okay, it goes inside the digestive system. And what it does, it ruptures the, because of that poison or the toxin, it ruptures the digestive canal of the pest. Okay, so what happens? The toxin is in inactivated form in the plant. So when the pest feeds on the plant, it ingests the toxin. When it enters into the body of the insect, it becomes activated. Okay, and directly it goes to the gut or the digestive canal. Okay, now it goes into the digestive canal and it ruptures it, and it results in the death of the pest or the insect. That is how it works. Okay, this was BT plants. Now it is used in tobacco, cotton, tomato, a lot of those things use the BT plants. Although there was in first when this was introduced by the scientists, and this was asked by the scientists for the farmers, they asked to the farmers that you can use this. At first, there was a lot of problems surrounding it, but because they were not sure that what will happen if the humans ingest it. Okay, is it safe enough? Because the insects are dying, what will happen to the humans when they ingest the same plant? Because there's already a toxin in there. That time, a lot of people did not want to eat these BT plants and BT products and all that. Okay, so after that, they checked and they saw this BT toxin is ineffective on humans. Okay, that is when they started again the use of this BT brinjal and everything. Okay, so although it is quite, what to say, it is quite ineffective against the pest, it is very ineffective in case of humans. So humans can directly ingest it and not think about the toxin at all. Okay, so if you have any questions, please write it again. Okay, please write it in the chat box so that we can interact more and I can solve your doubts. Okay, so next, now BT or the BT plants were effective, but they were not effective against all kinds of pests, only some pests. So that is where BT is not effective against all pests. Okay, so what happened? There were still some kind of problems, still some kind of pests which were still affecting the plants. One of them is this Meloidiagni incognita. Okay, this is a kind of nematode. Okay, it is not a bacteria, it is a nematode, and it affects the root of tobacco. So this was quite effective against the BT toxin, as we are, okay, we as humans, we are unaffected by the BT toxin. This one, this Meloidiagni incognita, they also were quite ineffective against the BT toxin. So that time, the scientists went back to the lab again, and they found the silencing translation of specific mRNA. Okay, I'll discuss about this again. So first, I'd like to say that about a little bit about M. incognita. Okay, they are eukaryotic organism. Okay, it's a nematode, as I said. So it's eukaryotic, it's not bacteria. Okay, and what happens is, now we all know that translation happens. What is translation? Translation is conversion of RNA into protein. Okay, and transcription is conversion of DNA into RNA. So, what happens in this plant, in this kind of plants where RNAi or RNA interference is used? What is done? They take a kind of a vector such as Agrobacterium and all. Okay, they take a vector and introduce a specific DNA against nematode. Okay, in the plant directly, they'll be putting the DNA in the, suppose this is a DNA, they'll be putting it into the plant. Okay, so now this DNA goes into the plant. Okay, this is specific. Okay, and this DNA, it transcribes and forms a double-stranded RNA. DS RNA. Now, why is this DS RNA so special? Because this DNS RNA, okay, has a sense strand and an anti-sense strand. Okay, so now it is already there in the plant. You can see that there is a DS RNA already there before the nematode acts. Now, when the nematode, suppose the nematode now acts on it. So the nematode acts. Okay, it comes and attacks the plant. So the nematode will give another RNA, a single stranded RNA, which will again, what nematode does, it gives out the RNA, okay, which creates a protein, and then it, what it does is it destroys the plant. Now, when this RNA comes, it attaches to this one, the sense and the anti-sense RNA. This was already there, and this RNA comes and attaches. So what happens? This RNA is silenced. Okay, because there is no protein production, so it is silenced. And this is how the plant cannot get disrupted. Because there's no protein, it does not get affected and it survives. So this is how the RNA is like helped, like RNA is silenced and the plant is helped from getting disrupted. See, so this is what happens. This is the nematode, as you can see. This is the nematode. And this is the plant cell. Okay, so what happens? The plant cell goes, the nematode goes, this is the mRNA. Okay, it goes, and there is the DSRNA. Okay, and it interacts. This one, it interacts, and it is silenced over here. There is a lot of risk complex with everything, the unzipping and everything. There are other mechanisms also. But the simple thing is the mRNA goes, attaches with the dsRRNA, and it becomes silenced. It cannot cell, cannot produce proteins. So this is how it is silenced. Now, if you have any questions or any doubts, please, please, please put it on the chat box so that I'll be able to see it properly. So, hello, hello, Chinu King. He has some questions. Ma'am, what do you think is better? Seeds, traditional seeds? Can you give your opinion on many points? Can you just say your questions properly? If you have any questions, you just repeat your questions so I'll be able to see it. I'll be able to answer it properly. I could not answer this question. I think Navodaya Memorial, somebody is asking about Danya ma'am. Today I'll be taking the class. I'm sorry if you're a bit sad about that, but I'll be taking the class today. So if you have any other doubts, please put it in the chat box. So the next thing, this is how the foods were used in the agricultural things and everything that was used in the biotechnology. There was a lot of ways by how it was treated. There was BT toxin. There was RNA interference. A lot of foods were produced which are actually being used right now, like flavor saver tomato and BT brinjal and everything. These things are actually being used right now. And right now, GMO foods are all in the rage because it does not take a lot of money to produce them, but it's quite effective and it's pest resistant and it does not get, there are no post-harvesting problems and everything. That and all is not present there. So now we'll talk a little bit about biotechnology in the medicine field. Now, biotechnology in the medicine field is vast, because it uses a lot of things. There are a lot of ways by which biotechnology has been exploited in the field of medicine. There are medicines which are being produced, there are transgenic animals, there is genetic engineering. So a lot of things is actually being used, say. The treatment of different diseases, diagnosis, protection, this treatment is there, this is vaccines, gene therapy for the you treatment of things like diseases like cancer and AIDS, now drug through genomics, this is genetic engineering, our DNA technology, everything. So there are so many things by the help of which the things are the biotechnology is being treated, biotechnology is being used in the field of medicine, starting from vaccines, our DNA technology, diagnosis like ELISA, PCR, so many things. Nowadays you heard a lot of things because we are going through a pandemic and you hear a lot of things. Have you taken the vaccines? Vaccines are a product of biotechnology. PCR, the diagnosis of COVID, that has been done with the help of biotechnology. So nowadays you learn a lot of things of like this. And you can see a lot of like even in day-to-day lives, using of injections, the insulin and other kinds of medicine, everything has been helped. Only because there was biotechnology involved in these things. So the first thing we'll be talking about, and the most important thing, is the genetically engineered insulin. Now, insulin, is used when a person has diabetes. To control diabetes, insulin is used. Just to control it, diabetes, as in we know sugar patients and all, In layman terms, it is known as sugar. So insulin has been used for that. Now, the thing is, insulin is quite rare, okay, because a lot of people nowadays, diabetes has actually wreaking havoc in the world. Okay? A lot of people have been continuously being diagnosed with diabetes. But the insulin which is produced is insulin production is less when in comparison to the need. Okay, this was a problem faced by a lot of pharmaceutical companies. Okay, there is a huge demand. Okay, there's a huge demand and the supply is very less. This was what was seen. So what they thought in the early days, what they thought is they can traditionally, human insulin was not available, so they started using insulin of animals, especially sheep and pigs. Okay, they started using the insulin from sheep and pigs. Now that is also a kind of insulin only. It's not that the sheep and pigs, whatever they were producing, okay, that was not insulin. That was insulin only. But the problem was there were additional elements also. Additional elements in insulin. Okay, what it created? It created allergy-like symptoms in humans. Because that is sheep insulin that is required to help sheep, or that was pig insulin that was required to help pig. Now, pigs and humans are not same, right? So even after purification and checking and everything, but still there was a lot of problems regarding the allergy. A lot of humans were facing a lot of allergical issues when they were using sheep insulin or pig insulin. Okay, so this is where the genetically engineered bacteria were used. Okay, GMs were used, genetically modified bacteria were used to produce insulin. Okay, so what has exactly been done? First, understand that insulin in our body is in an inactivated state. Okay, as you can see here, this proinsulin is inactivated. Okay, so proinsulin is inactivated. There is an A chain. Okay, and there is a B chain. Okay, an A chain and B chain is connected with a disulfide bond. Okay, so there is A chain and there is B chain, and it is connected with a disulfide bond. And this thing, this gray thing you can see, this is the C chain. What happens to the C chain when activated? C chain goes away. So this is the basic structure of insulin. There is an A chain and B chain, which is connected with the help of a disulfide bond. In proinsulin, there is a C chain also, which goes away when activated. See, this is an activated insulin. Okay, so this is what was learnt by the scientists, that this is how the insulin works. Now, what has to be done? This insulin has to be produced by bacteria. This is what they thought. This was their aim. So what they did, this is the whole picture what they did. I'll tell you step by step what happens. Okay. So what happens first? They take a bacteria. Okay. This is basically, it can be E. coli. Mostly they use E. coli. Okay, so now they use, this is the bacteria and it has plasmids. Okay, plasmid DNA. Now what they take, do they extract the plasmid DNA, is extracted. This is a normal plasmid DNA. This does not have a special gene or anything. Okay, so what they do, they extract the plasmid DNA and cut it with the help of enzymes. Okay, see, it has been cut with the help of restriction enzymes. They cut it. Then what they do, this is the part of human DNA genome. This is from chromosome 11. Okay, from chromosome 11, they take the gene out, which encodes insulin. Okay, so from chromosome 11, they take the gene out. Okay, and they cut it. Okay, they cut it. This is the special area. They cut it. And these have also sticky ends. They also have sticky ends and they stick it with the help of ligase. Okay, so they stick, this is the gene, this is the special gene, this is the plasmid, okay, and they, this is the plasmid for insulin production. Okay, this is the specialized plasmid. Now again, they'll put the plasmid inside, okay. See, they'll put the plasmid inside and inside the bacteria, and then the bacteria, now since it has the special genetic feature to produce the insulin, they will multiply. As you know, the bacteria multiply constantly and producing huge amount of insulin. Okay, so they, now they don't need a separate animal to produce the insulin and taking, purifying it and putting it into a human, which will cause a lot of allergy. This is directly from a human genome. Okay, this is not from any other genome. This is directly from the human genome. And this will directly produce, the bacteria will directly produce a lot of insulin from the human genome. Okay, so if you have any questions, please ask. Otherwise, I will move to the next part. Okay, the next is gene therapy. That was a kind of a medicine. This is a treatment method. So this is a treatment method. See, we have a lot of medicines for cancer. We have chemotherapy for AIDS also. They treat the symptoms, etc. But there is no proper, there are a lot of diseases, okay, especially genetic diseases, which do not have proper treatment. Okay, so this is what the scientists understood, that there are a lot of diseases like cancer, AIDS, other such autoimmune diseases, genetically involved diseases, which do not have a proper treatment. Now a normal gene in a person who has a autoimmune disease or any kind of genetically related disease, a normal gene has a defect. Okay, suppose a person has ADA, adenosine deaminase deficiency. Okay, so a normal person might have this. Now what they did, they directly treated the gene. instead of the symptom. So normally people go and directly treat the symptom, okay, whatever, if you're having some kind of uneasiness or fever or any other thing, people go directly treat the symptom. But what these scientists did, they directly took the gene out and treated it, okay, and then they put back the gene inside. This is how it looked. Although this kind of treatment is not ethical, they have a lot of ethical issues which I'll be talking about later, but this kind of treatment has been effective. But there are a lot of ethical issues, etc. Okay, so it's not very popular, but this is quite effective enough. So see what happens is, suppose this person has ADA, adenosine deaminase syndrome. Okay, so what they took, they take the cells. Okay, so the cells are harvested. These are the affected cells which are harvested. They're taken out. Now what they do, they take a vector with an unaffected gene. Okay, these people have affected gene. Okay, their genes are defect. Affected gene. So what they do, they take a vector. Vector can be anything. Vector is basically a carrier, okay, which have an unaffected gene. And it is inserted into a virus, this vector. And then this virus carries the ideal gene. Okay. Now this vector, as you can see, okay, this they'll put inside the cells. Okay. Since they have harvested the cells, they have taken out the cells. In these cells, they'll put the vector. Okay. And then that gene was not working, so they had the problem. Now they have a working gene. And finally, they'll put the cells inside the body, which will work. Now the problem is, although the process is actually, in talking terms, the process is actually very easy. Okay. Well, you take the cells out, you put the gene inside, the genes will start working, and you put the cells inside again. While talking, while I'm saying it, it seems very easy, but the process is not very easy. Okay, sometimes it can create a lot of problems, or sometimes it can create a lot of side effects. Okay, you don't know what is happening inside, right? So it can cause a lot of side effects. That is why there is an ethical issue. Okay, ethical issues are related to this treatment. Okay, when you go for treatments such as chemotherapy and symptoms handling and everything, those do not have ethical issues, because you're directly putting medicine or directly putting some kind of other kind of things, okay, which can help you with the symptoms. But this is directly affecting your body. Okay, you're taking a part of your body out, you're changing it, and then you're putting it inside. Okay. So this will definitely have an ethical issue, because you're taking a part out. Okay, so this has an ethical issue. That's why it's not very popular. Okay, so again, I'm saying, if you have any questions, please write it so that I'll be able to answer it. Okay. Okay, so those were the treatment things. Okay, now we have learned about the medicines, we have learned about the treatments. Now there is diagnostics. Diagnostics basically means, okay, like detecting of diseases. Now, as I said, when I began the class only, that time only, they said there's a lot of techniques related to my molecular diagnostics, and everything has been done with the help of biotechnology. Okay, they used to diagnose and monitor diseases and the therapies, etc. Early diagnosis, when other things such as CT scan and PET scan, other kind of scans, will only detect it when it is detected, when it is showing in your body. Okay, but this kind of treatment, the molecular, it will show when have slightest of problems only. They'll show when there's the slightest alteration of the genes, the slightest alteration of the chemical compound inside your body, that time only it will diagnose, and it does not have to be visible. Okay, so some of the main things which have been used is PCR. You know, PCR has been used for COVID diagnosis. Okay, this is the golden thing. Okay, they called it the golden standard. PCR is the golden standard for COVID diagnosis, because the other kind of diagnosis, such as the RAT, okay, the antigen thing, okay, that also takes some time. Only if you have a proper amount of antigen in your blood, then only they'll be able to diagnose it. But PCR is the only golden standard thing, okay, which can help you diagnose COVID. Okay, then there is ELISA, which helps the in diagnosis of HIV. Even sometimes cancer also it is used. Okay, ELISA, enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Okay, that is also has been used for HIV diagnosis. So these PCR, ELISA, rDNA technology, these and all are products of biotechnology. Okay, had there not been a biotechnology, these things would have not been there. Okay, so first we'll talk a little about the rDNA technology and the PCR, ELISA and all. So PCR is basically polymerase chain reaction. And why is it so used as a golden standard is because it uses very small amount of what to say, genetic material. Okay, so very small amount of sample that we'll be using, even a littlest. That is why RAT, the antigen test, requires that the whole body is affected or something. But this PCR does not need, even at the start of your disease also, if you give your DNA, if you give a bit of saliva, or if you give a little bit of swab, okay, they'll take the DNA and they'll amplify it. Okay, they'll make it into a bigger section, they'll just amplify it. That is why the PCR is so important, because it is amplifying. You don't have to give a lot of things, it's just amplifying your things. Okay, so what has been used? They use the sample. Okay, there are primers, nucleotides, there's a mixture. Okay, a proper PCR mix. Okay, with the samples, primers, buffer, and everything. And they use it. And there are three steps. Okay, so suppose this is the DNA strand. Okay, they denature it, goes up to a very high temperature, that is 95 degrees Celsius, they'll go. And it will become denatured, it will separate. Okay, then there'll be annealing. Okay, these primers, you see, these are also DNA. Okay, so they'll see these primers. In case of COVID, what will happen? These primers are COVID DNA. Okay. So what happens? They'll take the DNA strand out. Okay, suppose you have given your sample, they'll take your DNA strand out and they'll try to match the COVID DNA primers. Okay, suppose it matches. Okay, suppose the DNA, the COVID primer DNA and your DNA matches. Suppose there's a match, then you are positive. You have COVID. Suppose it doesn't match, then you are negative. This is what happens. The primers are basically the COVID primers. If it attaches with your DNA, so there is, you have COVID. If it doesn't, then you don't have it. And then, as I said, they amplify it. That little thing is only extension or amplification for detection. Okay, now you have a big, when you amplify it, if you have a big sample, you can say, okay, you're COVID positive or you're COVID negative. Okay, so that is how it works. Okay, so the next thing, ELISA. ELISA, as I said, ELISA is used for mostly HIV diagnosis. Okay, and ELISA means enzyme linked immuno sorbent assay. Okay, so this is ELISA and it works on the antigen antibody interaction. Suppose you have HIV. Okay, so you'll have an antigen. Because you carry the virus, you'll have an antigen, and because you'll have the antigen, you'll have the reaction, so you'll have an antibody. So this is where ELISA detects the presence of antigens or antibodies. ELISA just detects it. That is the purpose of ELISA. They'll have samples which will be similar to the HIV antigen or antibody, and they'll match the sample with the help of the antigens present in your body. So if you're positive, they'll match. If you're negative, they won't match. So that is the principle, basic principle of ELISA. Okay, now we'll talk a little bit about transgenic animals. Now, transgenic animals are actually, this is totally what it's used. We consider that animals, they clone it and they make newer kinds of animals, etc. Okay, they manipulate their DNA and foreign gene is introduced. Those kind of animals are known as transgenic animals. This is for betterment of human life. Okay, so there are a lot of things where the transgenic animals are used. Okay, as I said, study of insulin. Okay, so we cannot produce insulin, so they use the sheep or the what to say, rats and etc. to study insulin, to give out insulin. Study of diseases, such kind of models, they'll put a gene. Okay, they think this gene is causing Alzheimer's or cancer or cystic fibrosis. They'll directly put the gene inside the animal and see how the animals are reacting, or if any other medicines are working against it. You cannot do it on the humans, right? First, the first step has been to use for the study of diseases is to do it on animals. Okay. Now, biological products, insulin is also a biological product. Then there was in 1997 a cow, transgenic cow called Rosie, that produced human protein enriched milk. Okay, the milk was almost like human. Okay, and human alpha lactalbumin and nutritionally more balanced product. Okay, this was a balanced human milk. Okay, which was even more effective than a mother's milk. That kind of milk was produced by a cow called Rosie. Okay. So what they did, they took the isolation primary cells, okay, and then they used genetically transformed it, and then they again put it in the cow, and the cow became transgenic, which gave the special milk. This is how it worked. Okay, so continuously, even for vaccine safety and chemical safety testing, okay, you cannot directly test on humans. Okay, so makeup testing and medicine testing, first it has been done only on the animals. First they'll do it on animals and then only they'll do it on humans. First, if they say that it is effective on animals or the animals are actually fighting off the diseases, then only they'll put it on the humans. But there is a lot of ethical issue, because you cannot just, these animals, they cannot talk, so you cannot just exploit them. Okay, that is where ethics come into place. Okay, so a lot of scientists हैव बीन एक्सप्लॉइटिंग द एनिमल्स. सो टू कंट्रोल दैट ओनली, टू कंट्रोल दैट एथिकल इश्यूज हैज बीन अनाउंस्ड. ओके, देयर इज अ एज इन इंडिया दे हैव फॉर्मड अ GEAC, जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग अप्रूवल कमिटी, वेयर दे विल सी, ओके दे विल हैव टू गिव गो एंड से, ओके आई नीड टू यूज अराउंड 20 माइस और 20 शीप टू टेस्ट माई न्यू मेडिसिन और समथिंग. ओके, दे हैव टू सी इट इज नॉट रॉन्ग ऑन देयर पार्ट, और दे आर नॉट क्लोनिंग एनिमल्स कंटिन्यूअसली फॉर द बेटरमेंट. ओके, दोज काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स हैज बीन सीन, हैज बीन कंट्रोल्ड बाई द GEA. सो दिस इज फॉर इंडिया. देर आर अदर जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग बोर्ड्स ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड. देर इज अनदर थिंग विच हैज बीन यूज बाई द एथिकल इशू, इज द यूजिंग ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स. ओके, नाउ देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ जियोग्राफिकल प्रोडक्ट्स विच इज प्रेजेंट इन इंडिया, अब्रॉड एक्सेट्रा, लाइक थिंग्स लाइक बासमती राइस. ओके, बासमती राइस इज अ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ पंजाब बेसिकली, बट इंडिया इट वॉज नॉट दैट. मैन दे वर सेइंग दैट बासमती राइस वॉज एक्चुअली सो पॉपुलर एंड सच प्रॉब्लम वॉज सच सच सो मेनी प्रॉब्लम्स वर देयर रिलेटेड टू इट बिकॉज ऑफ द बासमती राइस, बिकॉज इट वॉज सो पॉपुलर एंड पीपल लाइक दैट टेस्ट. सो वॉट दे डिड, बट दीज पीपल वर नॉट टेक्निकली डेवलप्ड. Okay, so what US did, the people in US, they did, they took samples of basmati, okay, produced it there in their country and patented it, which was wrong. Okay, that was kind of a piracy. Okay, so they took it and they produced it and then they patented it. What happens when you patent it? When you patent it, that time the people there, okay, the people, they have to pay the price. It was their own product. People in Punjab had to pay the price to produce basmati. Okay, that was wrong because it was already patented there. These people were not technically developed, okay, and they did not patent it. Instead, the US people had patented it. Okay. And since they patented there, so if you want to grow it here, you have to pay. Okay. To grow, you have to take permission. To grow, you have to pay. So that is where the ethical issues were invoked. And this kind of thing is known as biopiracy, where people, okay, traditional medicines, traditional medicines, okay, such as turmeric and neem. Okay, the US people took these things also and tried to patent it because in India nobody was patenting it. Okay, India it was a general idea. Okay, you take turmeric, you get release of cold, and if you take neem, you'll have fresh skin, etc. etc. So many things. They never patented it. US people, they took this knowledge only and they tried to patent it over there, and these people had to pay royalty. So, this kind of, I don't know, this was kind of a thief, they were working as a thief, and this kind of cheating was done by a lot of countries. And that is where the GEAC came, the genetic engineering, the these boards, they came and they started talking about it, that you cannot just take things from India and then you cannot just produce it and say that it's your own and you have to pay. Because these things, turmeric, neem, basmati rice, these are all our geographical points, okay, and you cannot take it. So what they did, they made a lot of announcement and they fought against those people, and eventually they won. And now these things, okay, they cannot be patented. Okay, so knowledge cannot be Patented. Okay, just because you know something, you cannot dispute it. Okay, this traditional knowledge, etc., related to bioresources can be exploited to develop modern applications. So they, what did they do? They, these ethics department, they stopped doing that. It was happening for a lot of years before people started complaining, and they complained, they got an issue, and they said that these kind of things, you cannot just take it and wait it. Okay, so this is where it gets over, and if you have any doubts or anything, you can just talk to me. You can send put it on the chat box or anything if you have any doubts. Otherwise, then the next class we'll be learning a little bit about ecosystem, population, and everything. So please like, share, and subscribe to our videos. Okay, you can check a lot of videos. There's a lot of courses of NEET and other standards. Okay, from standard 6 to 12, you can find a lot of courses on the app as well as on YouTube also. Okay, and I hope you have a great day. Thank you. Bye bye.